Our help is in the name of the Lord who made the heavens and the earth. God is our refuge and our strength, an ever-present help in trouble, therefore we will not fear. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life, therefore those who believe in me will never die. We are here today to remember and give thanks for the life of T. Moffat Burris, Sr., and to celebrate his life and his homecoming, going home to his Lord. You may be seated. Let us pray. In life and in death, we belong to you, O Lord. You are the giver of life, and to you we owe our lives. We thank you that you give us each breath, each moment. And we thank you for the gift of life, and we thank you especially today for T. Moffat Burris, Sr. We thank you for his many talents and abilities that you gave him in this life, and we pray your earnest blessing upon this worship service today. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. In your bulletin is Psalm 23. Let us read this psalm in unison. We read this psalm at the time, the day of his death, together. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Our hymn is number 649. 649. We'll be singing the first, second, third, and fifth verses. Let us stand if you're able to sing. So stand. Thank you. be seated. None of us are perfect people, and we stand in need of God's forgiveness and grace. And when at a time of death, there's always a little bit of guilt. I wish I had seen that person a little more, or talked to that person more, or not said this or said that. It's time to confess our sins to God and to leave that in His hands. Invite you to do that using our corporate prayer confession in your bulletin in unison. Holy God, You see us as we are and know our inmost thoughts. We forget that all life comes from You and that to You all life returns. We have not always sought or done Your will. We have not lived as Your grateful children, nor loved as Christ loved us. Sustain us by Your grace. Lord, in Your mercy, forgive us, heal us, and make us whole. Set us free from our sin, and restore us to the joy of Your salvation, now and forever. Amen. Good news is that God promises to remove our sin as far as the east is from the west by the blood of Jesus Christ on the cross. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. This time, Scott Howell will come and deliver a eulogy about Moffett.
Man, I love this guy. What an honor it is for me to stand up here and speak to you today about someone I cared about very much. Moffett liked to call me his illegitimate son, but it's a title I carry with great pride, and I am grateful to the family for giving me this opportunity, because they're are 1,000 people more worthy than me today. We all know about Moffett's life, his accomplishments, his heroism. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about those things. There's a book and a movie and probably dozens of stories that you can find online. There is one story, however, I would like to share. If you've heard it before, I apologize. But I think it's one of those stories that's really worth repeating. Moffett fought in almost every major battle of the war. The fighting was always fierce, and his ability to escape death was legendary. Once there was this younger soldier, barely 18, scared and frightened, who just joined Moffett's company. And he asked a sergeant or someone, he said, how could he avoid being shot? You know, did the sergeant have any advice? The sergeant said to him, he said, see that man over there? That's Captain Burris. Just stand next to him. He's bulletproof. The next day, that same young man was wounded in combat. Shot in the head, so I'm told, and lived. While recovering, he saw that sergeant again. The private asked, I thought you said Burris was bulletproof. The sergeant replied, well, where were you standing? Private, right next to him. He said, well, that's the problem. You were supposed to stand behind him. And so the legend of a great man continued. This is tough. I first met Moffett when I was a sophomore at USC. I was a page in the State House. He was the minority leader. And being the minority leader, his desk was near the front, close to the page station where I worked. So I got to see him and know him up close. What I witnessed was something I didn't see much, I really didn't see much of growing up. I saw a great example of a man passionate about his work, serious about his legislative duties, respectful of his colleagues on both sides of the aisle, unwavering in his beliefs, and never, ever afraid to fight for what he believed in. He was uncompromising in his principles and consistently recognized and honored as a legislator with the highest integrity. He loved his family. He was a loving husband and father, as evidenced by the character of the children he raised and the grandchildren and great-grandchildren here today. Many of you know his first wife, Louisa, suffered from early onset Alzheimer's. Even when she no longer recognized him and was unable to communicate. Sorry, I have to have some water. When she didn't recognize him anymore and was unable to communicate, he demonstrated that unwavering and unconditional love that we are all so familiar with. When his second wife, Jean, became ill many years later, that same love and compassion stayed by her side until the very end. He was a man of great faith, a founding member of Eastminster Presbyterian Church, where he served as an elder. But Moffitt was never preachy or judgmental. He just lived a Christian life. He demonstrated to me every time I was with him that God doesn't expect you to be perfect. He just expects you to do right by him. He was a man of uncommon courage and humility. On a trip to Holland in 2010, a large group of us went to Nijmegen to celebrate the 65th anniversary of the liberation of that country. Now, if you want to go to a place that loves Americans, go to Holland. I've never seen any celebration before or since that was more touching, more patriotic, or bigger for that matter. These people love Americans. Tens of thousands of people turned out for the week-long celebration. Prince Philip of England was there, General Petraeus, and the Queen of Holland watched as the mayor of Nijmegen honored Moffitt with the Nijmegen Medal of Honor for his heroism during the war. It was an amazing experience, and probably one of the most amazing experiences of my life, to see this 90-year-old man, my friend, celebrated like a rock star. But in all that celebration, one thing stood out: his humility. It wasn't the queen or the honors that impressed Moffitt Burris. It was the people of Holland, their love for America, their appreciation for the sacrifices our soldiers made to help them regain their freedom. It was a week that I will remember for the rest of my life. Let me close on a more personal note. I've never fought in a war, led men into battle, or liberated a country. I've never been shot at or watched my friends die on the battlefield or in my arms. I've never been elected to office, sponsored a bill, or passed one law. And trust me, a movie will never be made about my life. There are enough bad TV shows about political consultants that we don't need a movie. But the day I met Moffitt Burris is the day my life changed forever. For the first time, there was a man I could look up to, a role model I could emulate, Someone who believed in me, saw potential in me, encouraged me, and helped me. I've had some great successes in my life. Because of Moffitt Burris, I was able to build a successful business doing something I love, politics. I've been married to the same woman for 24 years, and I hope I'll still be married to her when I get home. And together, we've raised two thoughtful, bright, honest, and loving children that I know Moffitt would be proud of. I would never have achieved these things, Weeza, John Hay, Moffitt, and Francis, if your dad had not been in my life. It's easy to be cynical in today's political environment to say politics makes, they say politics makes good people do bad things. I disagree. Truly good people always do good things. They always do the right thing. I knew Moffitt Burris for almost 40 years. I watched how he conducted himself, how he lived his life, how he treated other people, no matter where they came from. As a politician, a soldier, and a man, your daddy set the standard. His courage, humility, integrity, compassion, these are things we should all try to achieve. Moffitt Burris was a great man, not because of what he did, but how he did it. Today I'm a better man, a better father, a better person because of Moffitt Burris. And to his great-grandchildren, let me say this. I loved your great-grandfather. He was the greatest man I've ever known. Always remember him. Remember what he did. Remember how much he was loved by your parents and grandparents. And honor him in the way you live your life.
I want to read a letter given to the family. Family asked me to read. There have been many messages that thousands of messages that people have sent the family in condolence, and this is one that they just wanted to highlight of the many really good comments. This is from somebody in the legislature. I only knew your father from his days in the legislature when I was a research assistant in the Senate and later a budget and control board employee. However, during that time, I was able to take some measure of the man. Unlike a great many of his colleagues, I have the sense that your father was exactly the same man in the other environments of his life as he was in the legislature. I don't know if he was funny, quick, with a quip or not. However, he was always in a steady good humor. It made him very approachable and gave off an aura of kindness that cannot be faked. Whenever I worked with him, his interests in a given issue were completely transparent and unselfish. He wasn't afraid to identify a problem, but was always primarily interested in finding solutions. He was a man of many strengths, but uniquely among such men of my acquaintance, he did not lead with his strengths, nor did he seek to exploit the weaknesses of those with whom he was working. He was not above using his strengths to overpower an opponent or to exploit an opponent's weaknesses. He just always seemed to seek a win-win first. I'm fortunate in that I admire many of the men and women who have touched my life. When I think of them, their character and countenance inspires me and pleases me. So though I know his death is a great loss to you, your family, and his many, many friends, I'm thinking of him now, remembering the significant contacts I had with him, the way he conducted his business, and his open and honest approach to everything, and I'm filled with a very pleasant admiration. I'm certain of two things. One, I am not the only person touched by him to have this feeling. And two, this will not be the last time I have the pleasant occasion to call him to my mind. So the choir is going to lead us in God Bless America and invite you to stand, and we'll sing the chorus part together. It's found in your bulletin. Moffat did bless America. Some scripture today from Psalm 91, which I've always called the soldier's psalm, and from 2 Timothy 4 and Matthew 25, which speak to the end of his life. This passage in Matthew 25 is actually on the plaque for veterans that has Moffat's name on it in the honor tower that we'll be going to in a few minutes. Hear the word of God. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Surely He will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with His feathers, and under His wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only observe with your eyes, and you see the punishment of the wicked. If you make the Most High your dwelling, even the Lord who is my refuge, then no harm will befall you. No disaster will come near your tent, for he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. You will tread upon the lion and the cobra. You will trample the great lion and the serpent. Because he loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. He will call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. Then from 2 Timothy 4, this is found in the back of your bulletin, the bottom. For I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time for my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord will award not only to me, but to all who long for his appearing. Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So Moffat Burris Sr. was always ready to go. Francis would often arrange his speaking schedule to talk about his World War II events, and Moffat would just always be ready to go anytime. One of the kids would come up and say, let's go to Montreat, for they each have houses up there, and Moffat would always say, my bags are already packed, I'm ready to go. I think maybe he learned this because he was part of the greatest generation, as Tom Brokaw called it, perhaps one of the best of the greatest generation. And it's really sad to see that great generation go. But when Moffat was just 10 years old, maybe 11, his father died. And that was during the Great Depression. And his uncle sent them about $30 a month to live on as a family. But they survived, and no doubt that gave Moffat some flexibility in how he looked at things and also helped him to be a good steward of what he had. And I think that's been passed on to the next generation and the next generation of the Burrises. He graduated from Clemson University, and I asked Francis, how did he get to go to Clemson during such a tough time? And he said his brother actually went to Clemson for a year and then left Clemson to go to work to send Moffat through school. And Moffat seemed to always appreciate that sacrifice. He was a big football fan, as those of you who know him knew. He rejoiced at the Cotton Bowl, and I think he had plans to go see the national championship with John, but he saw it from a different perspective, and no doubt he was smiling. When I tried to find Moffat's home in the Lohman home when he moved there a year or so ago, I was wondering which room number it was. Then I saw the orange and white wreath, and I knew that was the place. You know, I would go to see him in the Presbyterian home when he supposedly lived there for several years, but he was never there. He was always gone. He was either gone to Montreat with his family and playing gin with four generations of Burrises, or he was gone to Dogwood down there in the lower part of Richland County to celebrate just being by himself. And he was the only resident I knew of the Presbyterian home who never stayed in the room that he had already paid for. His service to America during World War II, as many of you know, was just amazing. I mean, you read that book, Strike and Hold, and you think, nobody can make this up. I mean, this is better than fiction. The adventures and how many times, 21 times he almost was shot, but he escaped each time, and he was in Anzio, and he was in Sicily, and he was in Operation Market Garden. And, of course, they made the movie A Bridge Too Far about that operation. And Robert Redford played at least part of Moffat's character. And when I talked to Moffat about it, as anybody talked to Moffat about it, he would say, "Well, Robert Redford got paid a lot more for his 10 minutes than I got paid in 2.5 years. And I had the bullets flying at me." And to me, one of the most amazing stories from the war from Moffat was how toward the end of the war, and he was one of the first people to set foot in Berlin as an American, but one of my favorite stories is toward the end of the war, he and his two guys in his Jeep were kind of going ahead of the company, and they ran into a whole division of an armored division of Nazis, 15,000 men. And Moffat just went up to him, and he says that he bluffed his way through it. He said, "Now you can surrender to me, or you can surrender to the Russians who are right over there." And they talked about it, and the guy handed his gun over to Moffat. 15,000 soldiers surrendered to one guy and two friends in a Jeep. I mean, that's just, you can't make this stuff up. It's just an amazing thing. He had an amazing life, and to be one of the ones who helped liberate one of the concentration death camps was also an amazing story, and impressed Moffat about the reality of human evil and how bad things can be. He volunteered for the 82nd Airborne. He was ready to go. And maybe as a paratrooper, you got to be ready to go. And he received the Silver Star, the 3 Bronze Star, the Combat V, the Purple Heart, 3 Presidential Citations, French, Dutch, and Holland medals. He was making talks just a few months ago, and again, he was always ready to go and make those talks. After this service is over, we're going to go out to the breezeway here to what we call the Honor Tower. It's the steeple of the church, but it's called the Honor Tower, I really think, inspired by Moffat in many ways. I don't think it would be called the Honor Tower without Moffat. It honors our veterans there and honors some of our church leaders and things. But, you know, really Moffat leads in our desire as a church to honor our veterans, and he helped inspire that just by being here in his 90s in our congregation. He married Louisa, as Scotty pointed out, and they had 4 children, four wonderful adults now, and John and Francis and Moffat and Louisa, and they're his grandchildren, great grandchildren are just amazing. A lot of them are members of our church, and we are just so blessed by them, and we are certainly praying for them all. But Louisa got Alzheimer's disease, and Moffat went all over the country trying to find a cure for her. She was going blind, and if you go to Montreat and you go to Lake Susan, there's a gazebo the family built in her honor. And I think that's a great testament to Moffat and to his kids and family. He was a true servant of our state. He was elected to the South Carolina House, serving from 1976 to 1991 as a minority leader. For part of that time, he received the Order of the Palmetto. Moffat retired at 80 years old from his business, and you would think people at 80 years old would just kind of sit at home, but not Moffat. He was always ready to go somewhere, so Francis had just started up this medical missions thing, and it was an amazing adventure in and of itself. But Moffat, at 80 years old, went to Central America with Francis and South America to Peru, where they helped start 11 different new churches there. And it's an amazing, and medical clinics, it's amazing to see what they did down there, and went to Africa and started a hospital there as well. I mean, just Moffitt did not rest on his laurels. He didn't rest. He was all, when I talked to Moffitt, he was one of his proudest feats was parachuting into Holland at 90 years old. I mean, how can you do that? And he said, my goal is to parachute back into Holland at 100 years old. He didn't quite make that. But I don't doubt that heaven is not the same place since Moffitt is up there adventuring around. Psalm 91 that I read is all about God watching over us, blessing us, protecting us. And the very end of that psalm is a great verse that I really wanted to highlight for us. It says, with long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. Today we celebrate that with Moffitt. We celebrate that he had 99 years, and he had his mind up until the last little bit, and he knew your name. He could recall the name of, in his 90s, he could recall the name of almost everybody he'd ever met, and he just had a knack for that, and just brilliant. And, you know, you're tempted when you go to a retirement home like that to start yelling, because most people in there can't hear what you have to say. And I go, hey, Moffitt, how are you doing today? And he just look at me like, I'm fine, Ben. How are you? So he had his hearing, and he had a hearing aid, but he still could hear you very well. And God blessed him in many ways. And that is worth celebrating today. But more than that, even 99 years is very short compared to eternity. Moffitt was a believer. I knew that from the time I was a child and grew up in his church that he attended. I always looked up to him. He was someone who was always ready to go, but he was also ready to go home to his place in heaven. That's worth celebrating too, the ultimate place to go. And he was ready. He was not afraid. He was not afraid when he was in World War II. He was not afraid when he was in the legislature. He was not afraid when he was in business or when he was a family man. And I think his courage derived in part from his faith. And we can learn a lesson from that as well. If you ask Moffitt, he would say probably that we need to be careful that he was not Saint Moffitt. But he was St. Moffitt in many ways. And no person is absolutely perfect. But yet he is a great example for us all of his patriotism, of his hard work, of his always being ready to go out and serve somebody, to help somebody, and to make a difference for his Lord. Amen. Let us come to God in prayer. So, Lord, today we thank you for your servant, Thomas Moffitt Burris, Sr. We thank you for his many gifts that you gave him in life, that you gave him life, and you blessed him in this life, and he recognized that as well. Lord, thank you for his example, for his courage, for his service to our country, service to our state, for his service to people who are in need and to his family, for how well he loved them. Lord, we commend him to you and ask that you'd receive him into your presence with grace and with mercy. And we commend ourselves to you too. We commend his memory to our hearts and to you. We pray that you comfort this family and these friends as only you can, for you are the comforter. You are our strength and our refuge. You are our help. And we look to you to do that today. And now to you we pray the prayer you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant T. Moffat Burris, Sr. Acknowledge, we humbly pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of the everlasting peace, into the glorious company of the saints of light. Amen. Will you please stand for the benediction and the recessional? And may the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the peace that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in him, both now and forevermore. Amen.